Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the Cobham Theatre and to the 2023 Senior House Drama Competition. It's wonderful to see such a packed house, which is only going to get fuller and fuller. A big welcome to you all, but a very large welcome, please, to our adjudicator, Mr. James Hall. James Hall is a freelance writer and producer. He's currently the lead writer and co-executive producer on the BBC's Death in Paradise series, which I'm sure most of you will watch. He's been writing on it as story consultant and story producer on the series for the past 8 years. Prior to this, James has script edited and produced The Bill, Doctors, EastEnders and Holby City. Outside of his television work, James is also co-writer of the horror movie called The Forgotten in 2016. It looks dreadful that I'm reading this, but it's just because I'm so tired I can't remember anymore. You wrote a book for a young people's musical in 2008. We're delighted that you have made it outside the boundaries of the M25 tonight to take on the onerous task of adjudicator for us. We have at least one world premiere here tonight, and there are several aspiring script editors. We're very much looking forward to hearing from you later. So, ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Mr. Hall. And can I just take this opportunity to say a big thank you to the drama scholars that were on front of house duty this evening. A difficult task with so many people here. Many thanks, of course, to our theatre technicians, Mr. Jude and Mr. Poxon, for their constant support, and to their stalwart crew, Charlotte James, Joseph Hong, and Ruxang Tamang, who have sat through 16 hours of technical rehearsals over the past 10 days and are running the entire show this evening. No mean feat at all. Congratulations, and keep your wits about you, because I know the cast keep changing their minds about what they're actually performing. And finally, I have to thank Mrs. Claire Whitfield, our head of wardrobe, who has produced over 90 costumes for this, and is, I think she's already produced about 600 costumes since the start of this academic year. She is amazing. A huge thank you to her. Thank you. You're now going to see 12 plays that have all been directed and, more importantly, chosen by the students themselves. So I am not to blame for the next fun-packed 90 minutes of war, death, psychological torture, physical torture, more war, serial killings, poison, the firing squad, and gynecology. I don't know where they get their ideas from, but you are to blame. I have to say, with the pressures of A-level and GCSE coursework, the mock examinations, house quiz, so many really important sports fixtures and music fixtures in the last 2.5 weeks, I'm amazed that you are seeing anything now. I do not know how our students do it. They are under immense pressure, and the amount of dedication and focus that they have put into this is extraordinary. I am hugely proud of every single one of them, and I know you are, and you're in for a wonderful evening. Thank you very much indeed, and have a lovely time.
David, all right if I join you?
Of course, sir!
That's all right, lad. No need for formalities. Please, sit yourself down.
Thank you, sir.
I just thought you might like some company, you know, to talk things through. Or perhaps a prayer?
Never been one for prayer and all that, sir. I'm a bit late now, anyway.
Never too late, David. Perhaps later. Would you like to talk?
I didn't leave him, you know, sir.
You don't need to explain yourself to me, lad. You've already faced the court-martial. I'm not here to judge you again.
But I didn't! I didn't leave him! I went back for help!
We all do things we're not sure about at times, especially when we're under pressure and confused. We often overlook...
I wasn't confused! I went back to get help! Tommy was my best friend! I wouldn't leave him like that! Not in that field. That wasteland. Not with all that fighting and screaming going on. He was dying, sir! Lying in the mud! Dying! I went to get out! Sorry, sir, I didn't mean to.
That's all right, lad.
They let me write to Mum and Dad. Green letter, of course, vetted and all that. All I could write was that I loved them and missed them. I mean, what else could I say? Sorry, I'm going to be shot for desertion. Shot for trying to save my mate. And God save the king? And what about Tommy's family, eh? What would they think? With no one to tell them what really happened?
Perhaps you'd like to talk about something else.
It's all right, sir. I want to tell you what happened, if that's okay.
What happened to Tommy?
If that's all right, sir.
If that's what you want.
We were all geared up for the big push on the first. We was all stood in the trench watching Sergeant Lewis with his watch counting down till 7:30. Oh, it seemed to take forever. Tommy and I winked at each other, nervous-like.
Nerves, I should think. Understandable, given the circumstances.
Maybe. But I didn't feel nervous, although I could feel my heart racing. I just wanted to get on with it. I looked at the sergeant again as he put the whistle to his mouth. God be with you, men, he said as he blew, the noise of the whistle becoming lost in the yelling and the cheering. As I got to the top of the ladder, I lost my footing. I fell face first in the mud. But then an arm pulled me to my feet. It was Tommy. Come on, you useless bugger, he said. What good are you to the army if you can't even stand up properly? We'd already made it a few yards when all hell broke loose. Gunfire filled the air. You could feel the bullets whistling past your ears. It was worse than anything we'd seen before.
How much ground did you cover?
God knows. But the fighting was ferocious. As I got to a dugout, I saw one of our boys put his bayonet in the neck of a young German soldier and fire his gun in his face for good measure.
And how did that make you feel?
Young men on both sides, slaughtering each other, and for what? I know the generals would have an answer about the greater good and all that, but when you're standing in a field, in a mud-filled hole, watching your mates get blown apart by heavy artillery, the reasons for war become a little blurred. At least they did for me.
Look, I understand how you feel, David, but talk like that's not useful during times of conflict. It can often undermine men's resolve and actually costs lives.
I understand that, sir. I'm not saying we shouldn't be at war, just telling you how I felt in the moment.
Was Tommy still with you?
Yeah, but we didn't talk, though. Another hail of machine gun fire and we hit the ground. A corporal from the other troop was nearby. Right, lads, he shouted. Let's get the buggers. Oh, we'd not made it 10 or 20 yards when the machine gun fire started again. Tommy and I ran together. I turned to glance at him and... as I did so, he was struck in the chest. Body sort of lurched and staggered to a halt. I didn't know what to do. He looked at me for a moment and then just fell to the ground on his back.
Look, you don't have to do this, David.
It's all right, sir. I want to. I need to, really. I dropped on my knees to try to help him. He was just staring at me. He sort of gurgled and tried to say something, but I couldn't hear him. I reached across, I grabbed his hand and I squeezed it. It's all right, Tommy, lad, I said. I won't leave you. He was just looking right at me. We stayed there for what felt like an age. I didn't know what to do. I had to do something. I squeezed his hand again and I shouted that I was going to get help and I told him to lay still and not to die on me. Then I jumped to my feet and ran towards our trench, fast as I could.
Why didn't you go forward to catch up with your troop to get help that way?
Well, because the enemy was ahead and they were still firing at us. I don't know.
It's all right, David. What happened next?
Well, I got back to our trench. Stood there for a second with my eyes shut, just sucking the air into my lungs. But then suddenly I heard a voice. It was Captain Edwards. He asked me what I was doing, and I explained what had happened to Tommy, and I told him that I'd come back to get help. He asked me where my gun was, asked why I didn't stay with my troop, and said that if Tommy was such a good friend, then surely I would have carried him or stayed by him to protect him. Then he called over a couple of the other soldiers, told them to arrest me, under suspicion of cowardice and for desertion.
Do you think you should have stayed with Tommy?
I don't know. Oh, but I wish I had now. At least we'd have died together. And like the captain said, if I really cared about him, maybe I would have stayed. Maybe I did panic. I don't know. But I did what I thought was right. I really did go back for help, you know, sir.
I'm sorry, sir, but I'm afraid it's time.
All right, Corporal. At ease. Ready, David?
Will you be with me, sir?
Of course.
Put your jacket on, Private.
Fingers aren't working again, sir. I was wondering if you could...
That's all right. Here, let me help. There you are.
Thank you, sir. When you write home, sir, tell my dad and Tommy's family that I'm sorry. I'm sorry I let them down. And tell my mum that I love her. And I'm sorry that I made her cry.
I'll tell them, David.
We really need to go now, sir.
I think I'd like that prayer now.
Of course. We'll take a moment outside. Ready?
Thank you, sir.
Everyman. It shows how, at the end of our lives, we are all shown to be transitory. You will see how our heavenly King calls every man to a general reckoning. Listen to what he says.
Every man lives only for their own pleasure, and yet their own life is not assured. They forget completely the shedding of my son's red blood. The more patient I am, the worse they are from year to year. Therefore, I must have a reckoning on every man. Death, my mighty messenger, where are you?
I am here, ready to do your bidding.
Go to every man and tell him as my representative that he must take a journey that he cannot escape from, and he better bring a reckoning without delay.
Ah, I see every man walking over there. Meeting me is the last thing on his mind, for he is preoccupied with his own self and possessions. Every man, stand still.
Where are you going so cheerfully? Have you forgotten your maker?
Who wants to know? Oh, I've been sent to you from heaven by God.
What does God want from me?
He wants a reckoning from you right away.
Oh, death, you have come when I least expected you. Save me. I'll give you whatever you want if you be kind to me.
Oh, every man, that is not possible. Many have offered me gifts, but that is not my way. Now come on, be quick.
What? Not even a warning. To think of you makes my heart sick. I'm not ready to give a reckoning. Come back in a few years and I might be more prepared.
Aw, it's no use to cry, weep, or pray, but see if any of your friends might accompany you. For death waits for no man. All living creatures must die!
Oh God in heaven, have mercy on me. Shall I have no one to join me on this journey?
See if anyone might be daring enough to accompany you on this journey.
Who might help me now? Oh, maybe friendship. We've been close for years. Surely she'll help me. I'll speak to her right away.
Oh my God, Everyman! Oh, so good to see you.
Oh. Oh, why do you look so sad? If something is wrong, please tell me so I can help you.
Yes, dear friendship, I'm in real trouble.
My true friend, tell me what's wrong. Through thick and through thin, you could always count on me.
You're a good friend. You have never disappointed me before.
And I never will, I swear. Even if you were to go to hell, I would stay.
I've been told to go on a journey, to give a reckoning before God. Please come with me as you promised.
Ah, that's tough luck, but if I were to accompany you, it would be painful for me, and the very thought scares me.
Indeed, death was here with me just a moment ago.
If death was the messenger, then I will not go with you. I will not go on that journey even for my own father.
But my friend, you promised.
Yeah, I'll leave you in God's hands.
You're forsaking me?
Yeah, sorry.
Where else can I turn to for help if even friendship fails me? I know. I'll go to my family, because blood is thicker than water. Kindred, are you there?
Oh dear, you can always depend on your family.
I've been told to go on a journey, to give a reckoning before God. Please come with me and help me give account.
What? But oh, you're so young and married.
Take heart, but no, I won't go with you.
My cousin, will you go with me?
No, I have a cramp in my toe.
Yeah.
Tell me the truth. Will you come with me or stay behind?
Stay behind? Oh, you better believe it.
I will. All my life I have loved riches. Maybe now they'll help me. My goods and possessions have made my heart light before. Where are you, my goods and riches?
Here, sir. If you have any trouble, I can help.
I've been told to go on a journey, to give a reckoning before God. Please come with me and help me give account.
Girl, no. Every man, I sing another song. I follow no man in such voyages. If I did go with you, it would go worse for you, because you set your hope on me. Your love for me will be your undoing, girl.
Yes, I have loved you and had great things and the things your treasures have provided for me.
Now that is your damnation, because the love of money goes against eternal love. If you love me more moderately and share me with some of the poor, you will not be in this trouble. Mm-mm, you know what? Girl, bye.
Curse you, Fulton. You deceived me. You traitor. Oh, my, come with me now. Maybe good deeds, but she's so weak. She hasn't the strength.
I'm sorry, Everyman. I'd come with you if I was stronger and more able.
At least give me some advice.
I'll be happy to. I have a sister named Knowledge who will go with you.
Everyman, I will go with you and be your guide. You know need? I will stay by your side. We can go together to the cleansing river of confession.
Oh, glorious river. I come with knowledge for my redemption.
I know your sorrow well, Everyman. And since you have come to me with knowledge, I will comfort you as best I can. I have given you penance.
I leave you in the hands of our Savior to assure your reckoning.
I'm free from my sickness! Now I can go with Everyman!
Oh, my good deeds. Now I hear your voice and I weep for the very sweetness of your love.
Now, listen to me. Go to Priestley. He will give you the holy sacrament and ointment. Then return here to us.
Okay. Now I receive the sacrament for my redemption. Now, come on, friends. We must go on without further delay. Oh, I cannot go a step further. I must creep into this cave and rest.
But this is a grave. Don't worry. I'll stay with you.
I'll stay with you, Everyman. Don't worry. I'll go. I'll leave you, but not until you go to death. I think I hear angels singing and making great joy.
Come, beloved of Jesus. Here above you shall go.
Everyone, this is the moral. Let go of your pride. They all abandon Everyman in the end. Everyone, except his good deeds. But be aware, if your good deeds are small before God, you will have no one at all. For after death, no man may make amends. So ends the moral play of Everyman. Look well and take good heed.
Oh, not far from Mr. Hector, sir. He might even give you a lift if you asked him.
It's not a loft, is it, sir?
Do you exist on an unhealthy diet of takeaway food, sir? Or do you prefer a gourmet meal for one?
Or is it a lonely pizza, sir?
I manage. No questions from you, Dakin?
What they want to know, sir, is, do you have a life, sir? Or are we it? Are we your life, sir?
Pretty dismal if you are, because these are as dreary as ever. You get a question, you know the answer. But so does everyone else. So say something different. Say the opposite. Take Stalin. Generally, you're going to be a monster. And rightly. So dissent. Find something. Anything to say in his defence. A question is about what you know. Not about what you don't know. A question about Rembrandt, for instance. Might prompt an answer about Degas.
Is Degas an old master, sir?
About suffering. They were never wrong, sir, the old masters. About how it takes place while someone is eating or opening a window.
Have you done that with Mr. Hector?
Done what, sir?
The poem. You were quoting somebody. Auden.
Was I, sir? Sometimes it just flows out. Brims over.
Why does he lock the door?
Lock the door?
Does he lock the door?
Does he have a programme? Or is it just at random?
It's just knowledge, sir.
The pursuit of it for its own sake, sir.
Breaking bread with the dead, sir. That's what we do.
It's higher than your stuff, sir. Nobler.
Only not as useful, sir. Mr. Hector's not as focused.
No, not focused at all, sir. Blurred, sir, more.
You're much more focused, sir.
And we know what we're doing with you, sir. Half the time with him, we don't know what we're doing at all.
We're poor little sheep that have lost our way, sir. Where are we?
You're very young, sir. Isn't your gap here, is it?
Oh, I wish it was. Why, sir? Do you not like teaching us, sir? We're not just a gap between the end of university and the beginning of life, like Auden, are we, sir?
Do you like Auden's poetry, sir?
Some.
Mr. Hector does. We know about Auden. He was an old schoolmaster for a bit.
I believe he was, yes.
He was. Do you think he's more like you, or like Mr. Hector?
I've no idea. Why should he be like either of us?
I think he was a bit more like Mr. Hector. A bit of a shambles. He snogged his pupils. Oh. Auden, sir. Not Mr. Hector.
You know more about him than I do.
There, your sleeping head, my love. Human on my faithless arm. That was a pupil, sir. Shocking, isn't it?
So, you could answer a question on order.
No, sir.
Mr. Hector's stuff's not meant for the exam, sir. It's to make us more rounded human beings.
Listen. This examination will be about everything and anything you know and are. If there is a question about Auden, or whoever, and you know about it, you must answer it.
We couldn't do that, sir. That would betray the trust.
Nothing sacred, sir. We're shocked.
I would, sir. And they would.
England, you have been here too long, and the songs you sing are the songs you sung. On a braver day, now they are wrong.
Who's that?
Don't you know, sir?
No.
Sir, it's Stevie Smith, sir, of Not Waving But Drowning fame.
Well, don't tell me that is useless knowledge. You get an essay on post-imperial decline, losing an empire, and finding a role, all that stuff. And a gobbit like that is the perfect way to end it.
A what, sir?
A gobbit. A quotation. How much more stuff like that have you got up your sleeves?
Oh, we've got all sorts, sir. The train!
It's red!
Hey!
I really meant to do it. I stood there trembling right on the edge, but I couldn't.
I wasn't brave enough. I would like to be able to say it was the thought of you and the children that prevented me, but it wasn't. I had no thoughts at all, only an overwhelming desire not to feel anything ever again, not to be unhappy anymore. I went back into the refreshment room. That is when I nearly fainted.
Nora!
Yes, dear.
Whatever your dream was, it wasn't a very happy one, was it?
No.
Is there anything I can do to help?
You always help, dear.
You've been a long way away. Thank you for coming back to me.
God knows why you've done a brief encounter.
Thank you.
But I think you ought to know, this lesson has been a complete waste of time.
Bit like Mr. Hector's lessons then, sir. They're a waste of time too.
Yes, you little smart ass. But he's not trying to get you through an exam.
Woman died in the infirmary. She'd been taken there earlier this afternoon after swallowing a lot of strong disinfectant. Burned her inside out, of course. I've been round to the room she had, and she'd left a letter there, and a sort of diary. Like a lot of these young women who get into various kinds of trouble, she'd use more than one name. But her real name, her original name, was Eva Smith.
She was a lively, good-looking girl. A good worker, too. She'd been working one of our machine shops for over a year. In fact, a foreman there told me he was ready to promote her into what we call a leading operator, head of a small group of girls. But after they came back from their holidays in August, they were all rather restless, and they suddenly decided to ask for more money. They were averaging about 22 and 6, which was neither more nor less than is paid generally in our industry. They wanted the rates raised so that they could average about 25 shillings a week. I refused.
Why?
Did you say why?
Yes. It's my duty to ask questions.
Well, it's my duty to keep labor costs down. And if I'd agreed to this demand, we'd have added about 12% to our labor costs. Does that satisfy you? So I refused. Said I couldn't consider it. We were paying the usual rates. And if they didn't like those rates, they could go and work somewhere else. It's a free country, I told them.
I'm going to try something on. Well, when I tried the thing on and looked at myself, I knew it was all wrong. I caught sight of this girl, smiling at Miss Frances, as if to say, doesn't she look awful? I was absolutely furious. I was very rude to both of them. And then I went to the manager and told him that this girl had been very impertinent and how could I know what would happen afterward? She'd been some plain, miserable little creature. I don't suppose I'd have done it. But she was very pretty and looked if she could take care of herself. I couldn't be sorry for her. In fact, in a kind of way, you could be said to have been jealous of her. Yes, but it didn't seem to be anything very terrible at the time. Don't you understand? It never could help her now.
Yes, but you can't! It's too late! She became your mistress. yes, I suppose it was inevitable. She was young and pretty and warm-hearted and intensely grateful. I became at once the most important person in her life. You understand?
Yes, she was a woman. She was lonely. Were you in love with her?
Just what I was going to ask.
It's hard to say. I didn't feel about her as she felt about me.
Of course not. You were the wonderful fairy prince. You must have adored Gerald.
All right. I did for a time. Nearly any man would have.
Did you go and see her every night?
No. I wasn't telling you a complete lie when I said I'd been very busy at the works all that time. We were very busy, but of course, I did see a good deal of her.
If you think you can bring any pressure to bear upon me, Inspector, you're quite mistaken. Unlike the other three, I did nothing I'm ashamed of other than Womberang investigation. The girl asked for assistance. We were asked to look carefully into the claims made upon us. I wasn't satisfied with the girl's claim. She seemed to me not a good case, and so I used my influence to have it refused. And in spite of what's happened to the girl since, I consider I did my duty. So if I prefer not to discuss it any further, you have no power to make me change my mind.
Yes, I have.
No, you haven't. Simply because I've done nothing wrong, and you know it.
I think that you've done something terribly wrong, and that you're going to spend the rest of your life regretting it. She'd been turned out and turned down too many times. This was the end.
You know, don't you?
Yes, we know.
She wasn't the usual sort, but well, I suppose she didn't know what to do. There was some woman who wanted to help her go there. I never quite understood about that.
You went with her to her lodgings that night?
Yes, I insisted, although I'm not quite clear about it. Afterwards, she told me that she didn't want me to go in and that... But I was in a state where a chap easily turns nasty and I threatened to make a row.
So she let you in?
Yes. And that's when it happened. I don't even remember. That's the hellish thing. Oh my God, how stupid it all is!
Eric, you can't
and be quiet for a moment and listen to me. I don't need to know any more, and neither do you. This girl killed herself and died a horrible death. You each helped to kill her. Remember that. Never forget it. Remember what you did, Mrs. Burling. You turned her away when she most needed help. You refused her the pitiable little bit of organised charity you had in your power to grant her. Remember what you did.
My God, I'm not likely to forget.
Just used her for the end of a stupid, drunken evening, as if she was an animal, a thing, not a person. No, you won't forget.
I know. I had her turned out of the jaw. I started it.
You helped, but you didn't start it. You started it. She wanted 25 shillings a week instead of 22 and sixpence. You made her pay a heavy price for that, and now she'll make you pay a heavier price still.
Look, Inspector, I'd give thousands, yes,
thousands! You're offering the money at the wrong time, Mr. Burling! No, I don't think any of you'll forget.
That's the worst of it.
But just remember this. One Eva Smith is gone, but there are millions and millions and millions of Eva Smiths and John Smiths still left with us, with their lives, their hopes and fears, their suffering and chances of happiness, all intertwined with our lives and what we think and say and do. We don't live alone. We are members of one body. We are responsible for each other. And I tell you that the time will soon come when, if men will not learn that lesson, then we will be taught it in fire and blood and anguish. Good night.
used it to grab her.
Four canonical victims! Catherine Eddowes, murdered 30th of September, 1888. Her skirt was raised and her throat slit twice. Her intestines were removed and placed upon her shoulder and her stomach cut from her navel to her rectum.
Fifth canonical victim, Mary Jane Kelly, murdered 9th of November, 1888. Her naked body was found, mutilated beyond recognition, with most of her facial features being removed. Her tissue was found on her table and windowsill, and her heart was taken as a prize. It is suspected that it took the Ripper 2 hours to complete the mutilations.
Every canonical victim! Murdered! 1888!
I do wish you'd stop that.
Yes, please do.
Please stop it, Mother.
Sorry, it's the nerves.
If only your nerves could be a bit quieter.
Do you think she'll be all right?
Clara, I mean.
Oh, of course she will. How hard can it be to pick up a few report clippings?
You see, Mother, everything's going to be fine. You mustn't bother. You're putting them off.
I know it's just. Are you sure about all this? Is all this hustle worth one potentially good story?
Mother, we've been over this. A story about Stoker and Clark, a pair of unknown female detectives trying to solve the biggest mystery known to London. It's sure to get me a promotion at the newspaper. I shouldn't have let you come. How am I supposed to be a serious journalist with my mother babysitting me?
I'm here because I'm worried about you, Florence. You haven't been the same since your father died. You've been so busy at work, I hardly see you anymore. So please, forgive me if I want to accompany my daughter to work when there's a murderer on the loose.
Sorry, Beatrice, could you run me through the plan again? I'm not quite sure.
Oh,
how
for goodness sake, we've been over this.
Beatrice, don't lose your temper.
Clara has been sent to the archives to retrieve old report clippings that we know for a fact are linked to our friend Jack. So tell me, why do we need these report clippings?
To try and make a connection between the victims.
Oh, we already know the connection! They were bloody murdered! Elizabeth, explain! It's your name on the door too, you know!
Though both Beatrice and I are admittedly brilliant detectives, that does not mean that we are immune to human error. There must have been something we missed. The cycle must stop with Maria Kelly.
Mary?
I'm sorry?
Mary. Her name was Mary.
Oh, that's what I said.
No, you didn't. You said...
Anyway, there must be something in the reports that hints to the identity of the killer. The souvenirs he takes from his kills.
Something found on the victims or something taken from them.
I see. So what you're saying is, if we find a clue on the victims' autopsies hinting towards the preferences of the killer...
Then we're one step closer to finding out who he is. Good work, Florence. So everyone just sit tight and wait for Clara to get back.
Right, that's it. I'm going after her.
Ah!
We have discussed this. I know, it's getting late. And it's not safe for a young girl to be out there alone on the streets. Besides, it's been hours since she left.
Exactly, she's probably on the way back as we speak.
Actually, I'm getting worried about her too.
No! It will jeopardize the investigation. This promotion is too important to me. Clara could just... stay out there.
Florence King, how dare you speak about your best friend like that? For years I have watched as you have shoved that poor girl under the rug. I love you, Florence, just sometimes you can be downright selfish.
Can you two stop fighting? If we want this investigation to work, we need to learn to cooperate. My friend is dead. And all the four of you can do is squabble. She said she'd be back at 12. So we'll wait for her.
Clara!
Clara, my dear, are you all right?
I was
organising goes. Just trust me on this. Look at this one, then this one, then this one, and then this one.
Is that what I think it is? Beatrice, come here!
Clara, what have you found out? What's happening? It's the connection we've been looking for. A certain newspaper covered the murders of every victim that the police know of. The word Ripper is spelled at the beginning of each paragraph and each account through the first letter.
Ah, revulsion strikes the streets of London.
Aye, investigators have concluded.
P, promising lead is found.
P, prostitution was clearly a motive for this crime.
E, early in the morning her body was found.
Ah, rest in peace, Mary Nichols. It's like this for every victim. Well done, Clara. Oh, truly a remarkable find.
But what does it mean? We know he likes to be seen. Remember his dear boss letter. Textbook attention grabbing.
Publishing this in the newspaper for everyone to see shows a classically disturbed mind. Our next step is to figure out which paper published these reports.
Oh, that could take a lifetime. There were hundreds of newspaper companies in London. And I found these reports shoved in a pile and to check the Ripper's name. There was no organisation at all. So the source will be even harder to find.
But I recognise it. And you should too, Florence. The typeface, the size, and why? It's identical to Chronicle's publication.
You mean father published this?
No, not your father, but Anthony, your boss. When he took over the company, he changed that classic right, and I told him it would send the sales down.
How much power does this Anthony have?
Oh, he's head of the company. Nothing goes through to print without his seal of approval.
Well, Florence, I think you're getting that promotion after all.
Me about.
I beg your pardon?
I'm afraid there's been a mistake. We're all booked in. Your room is taken. You'll have to find somewhere else.
Are you the manager here?
That's right. So I'm afraid you and your friends will have to find other accommodation.
Oh, I forgot. I must congratulate you on your birthday. Congratulations.
Perhaps you are deaf.
No? What makes you think that? As a matter of fact, every single one of my senses is at its peak. Not bad going, eh? For a man past 50. But a birthday. I always feel there's a perfect occasion, taken too much for granted these days. What a thing to celebrate. Birth. Like getting up in the morning. Marvellous. Some people don't like the idea of getting up in the morning.
Get out. Get those drinks out of here! This is an unlicensed premises!
You're in a terrible humour today, Mr. Webber.
I said...
And on your birthday,
I
too.
Said, get those drinks out of here!
Mr. Webber, sit down a minute.
Now, you just listen to me this minute. You two don't bother me. To me, you're nothing but a dirty joke. But I have a responsibility to the people in this house. And I will not let anyone take advantage of them while I'm here. Anyway, this isn't your cup of tea. So why don't you just leave without causing any more fuss?
Mr. Webber, sit down.
Why should I?
To tell you the truth, Webber, you're really getting on my breast.
Really? Well, that's it down! No!
McCann?
Nat?
Ask him to sit down.
Yes, Nat. Do you mind sitting down?
Yes, I do mind.
Yes, now. But it'd be better if you did.
Why don't you sit down?
No, not me. You.
No. Thanks.
Nat?
What?
He won't sit down.
Well, ask him.
I've asked him.
Ask him again.
Sit down.
Why?
You'd be more comfortable, so would you. All right, if you will, I will. You first. Well, right, now you're both on arrest, you can get out!
That's a dirty trick! I'll kick the shite out of him!
No!
I've stood up.
Sit back down again.
Once I'm up,
same here!
You've made Mr. Goldberg stand up!
It's all doing good!
Sit in that seat!
Pretend.
Get down in that seat!
Mr. Webber, sit down.
You'd better be careful.
What were you doing yesterday, Webber?
Yesterday?
And the day before. What were you doing the day before that?
What do you mean?
Why are you wasting everybody's time, Webber? Why are you getting in everybody's way?
Me? What are you...
I'm telling you, Webber, you're a washout. Why are you getting on everybody's wits?
He likes to do it.
Why did you behave so badly, Webber? Why did you force that old man out to play chess?
Me?
What did you wear last week? Where did you keep your suits?
Why did you leave the organisation?
What would your old mum say?
Why did you betray us?
You hurt me, Webber. You're playing a dirty old game.
You're on the wrong horse.
When did you come to this place?
Last year.
Where did you come from?
Somewhere else.
Why did you come here?
My feet hurt.
Why did you stay?
I had a headache.
Did you take anything for it?
Yes.
What?
French socks.
He knows where Andrew's.
In.
Did you stir properly?
Did they fizz?
No, wait, you!
Did they fizz? Did they fizz or didn't they fizz?
He doesn't know!
You don't know. When did you last have a bar?
I have one in.
Don't lie!
Why did you betray the organisation?
I know it.
You don't!
What can you see without your glasses?
Anything! Take off his glasses.
What?
What?
Oh!
Whether you're a fake. Where is your wife?
In.
What? Answer.
What wife?
What have you done with your wife?
He killed his wife.
Why did you kill your wife?
What wife?
How did you kill her?
How did you kill her?
You throttled her.
With arsenic.
Claire's your man. Webber, why did you change your name?
I forgot the other one.
What's your name now?
Joe Soap.
You stink of sin.
Oh, I can smell it.
Do you recognise an external force?
What?
Do you recognise an external force?
That's the question.
Do you recognise an external force responsible for you, suffering for you?
It's late.
Late enough. When did you last pray?
He's sweating.
When did you last pray?
He's sweating.
Is the number 846 possible or necessary?
Neither.
Wrong. Is the number 846 possible or necessary?
Neither.
Wrong. It's only necessarily possible.
Both.
Wrong. Why do you think the number 846 is necessarily possible?
It must be.
Wrong. It's only necessarily necessary. We admit possibility after we grant necessity. It's only possible because necessarily by no means necessary through the possibility. Possibilities can only be assumed after proof of the necessity.
Right.
Right. Of course, right. We're right and you're wrong all along the line.
All along the line.
Where is your lechery leading you?
You'll pay for this.
You stuff yourself with dry toast.
You contaminate womankind.
Why don't you pay the rent?
Mother defiler.
Why do you pick your nose?
I demand justice.
What's your trade?
I play the piano.
How many fingers do you use?
No hands.
No society would touch you. Not even a building society.
You're a traitor to the cloth.
What do you use for pyjamas?
Oh, nothing.
You verminate the sheet of your birth. Speak up, Webber. Why did the chicken cross the road?
He doesn't know.
Why did the chicken cross the road?
He doesn't know. He doesn't know which came first.
Which came first?
Chicken, egg, which came first?
Which came first?
Which came first?
Which came first?
Thank you.
food should be getting on with. Come on then, let's have ya. Move it, move it.
Go on, move yourselves. Gilo, lakas, lakas.
Oh, how long we here for? Half an hour or so, and then we'll push off. Better man with guards. 2 men, 15-minute shifts.
Right.
Bear forth. Bear forth!
You want me, Corp?
Go on your feet, then.
What's up?
Said move! Think you're on your holidays? Get your back on.
You're going to inspectors, Corp.
Don't give me any of your mouth. Get your back on. Smartish. Next time, keep it on till you hear different.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, right on. You heard what he said? I want 2 men. First stag, 2 volunteers. Come on, come on.
First I'll ask, what's the odds?
It's all the same to me.
Better stay inside. Don't show yourself. Cover the front. If anything's coming, it should come in from out there. How's the set?
It's dead. Still is. Unserviceable. Can't get a peek. I think the battery's given up. Chonking out.
Keep at it, Sammy, son. Have another shot at getting through.
Blue Patrol to Red Leader. Blue Patrol calling Red Leader. Are you receiving me? Are you receiving me? Come in, Red Leader. Come in, Red Leader. Over.
Damn duff equipment. Oh, damn issues, duff. Time Jack will get back. Tomorrow, about 800 hours or so if we keep it up. Roll on, roll on. Let's get some kit.
Yeah, if you get the chance. Key inspection Saturday morning. What's the bang? We'll knock on the square after that. See how it's bright.
Not this, boy. I'm going to grab the weekend off and chuff the expense.
Sarge. Sarge!
Hold it, all of you. What's up?
I thought I saw a movement down the track. It's there again!
Get down! Get out of sight! How many of them? Can you see?
No. Out of sight again. Behind the trees. Heading this way.
Which way are they coming from?
Long track. Down there. About 50 yards.
Evans?
I see a ruddy thing from out here, Sarge. Not as far as that.
It's a clump of blasted bushes in the way. Were they Japs?
Might have been anything. Only had a glimpse.
Are you sure, Banforth?
Meaning what?
You saw anything at all, lad?
You think I'm going round the bend?
All right. We'll take your word for it. If there is anyone down there, they should come to sight again just by that.
A Jap.
I've got him. On his own. Now keep still, all of you. This one's honest, Todd. Could be a scout. He hasn't seen this place up to press. Got him, Jono?
Can't see a thing for this ruddy bush.
Whereabouts? Just less than 50 yards, straight ahead. Got him, have you?
No, not yet.
He's found the trail. He's found the trail, all right. He's found a place to have a crafty smoke.
Just what, Bamo?
Having the drag, he's lighting up a fag. Or the crafty old nip. The sky even get caught red-handed. Nip down and ask him for a puff tap.
Of all the rotten luck he would choose this place, we'll wait and see if he pushes off. I said no noise.
What's happening?
He's up. He's standing up and nicking out the knob. He's going back the way he came. Stop. Turning round. He's coming back. He's found a track up here. He's coming up.
Move it then, the rest of you. Let's have you over by the wall. I'll bring your gear. Berkoff, Evans, down on deck. Keep still, all of you. There's just a chance he might not see us yet. In case he does, Johnny, if he should come in, you grab without a sound. I'll cover the front in case. Still coming up. Close to the walls you can. He might not see us yet.
Sarge, the set!
Oh, good lad, get it quick! There it is, everything!
Hold him still!
Well, hold it!
English, York! Hey! Comprende! Hey! Hey! Trust me to cop a raving lunatic.
Yeah.
Now listen,
sir.
You make so much as a mutter and laugh and bore to set your guts up to your ears.
I'm here.
Okay. Okay. Good. One moment, Jack. And Jack the Ripper. I'll give you a visit.
Yeah. So.
Universal talk. I think I'm getting through to him now.
Sergeant.
Put the carbon knife away before he ties on us with fright.
Boom!
Bevorov! Jack it in! I said put the paddling away.
All right. Thanks, Tap.
Right, Jono. He'll be a good lad.
He'll behave himself.
Put him down.
After him, God help me.
And what?
And where are we, dear? Always good to let them know the basics to start with.
Sorry?
The year, dear. The date. Anno Domini, as the educated people say. Clue, dear.
1596.
That's right, dear. 16th century. So if you wouldn't mind, act one, scene one. And since it's the 16th century, blank verse, all right?
Okay, blank verse. Here goes. Who am I by Orlando, July 1596. Shall I compare me to a summer's day? I am as sweaty and intemperate. Rough winds do toss this darling. No? No, way too soon. Okay. Shall I compare me to a tumbling ship that lunges like a rearing horse, that cleaves, yes, that cleaves the air like a well-swung blade, that carves through life from deed to shining deed, and finds, something, anything, so long as it's hard, right? Because if your heart has nothing hard to attach itself to, in the midst of all this, do you see? Because I, Orlando, every night around this time, because there's this moment, right, when the lamps have just been lit and the sun is sinking, I leave the house and I walk up the hill that we have here in the park. And the house is ridiculous when you look back at it. I mean, 365 rooms. Who needs that much space? Especially in the country. But anyway,
it, so I guess. Anyway, the light up there on the hill, it makes you feel, it makes you feel like you can see forever because everything's so still, you see so intense. And I stand there and I feel
alone.
I feel I am alone. Do you see? Sorry.
I'm not saying the line twice, dear. Second serving woman at this point in my career, I ask you. Anyway, Queen Elizabeth the First, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, everyone. Born September 1533, and let me tell you, if that woman has changed her linen since the Armada, then my name's Sir Walter Raleigh. Smells like a sort of cupboard down there. But one full of very old fur, do you know what I mean? You, manners, and try and find out why he's come.
Your Majesty.
But we are forbid to tell the secrets of our virgin state. We could, young man, a tale unfold whose lightest word would tangle up thy heart, make each particular hair thou hast to stand like quills upon a lustful porpentine. But such queen regal secrets must not be for general ears. Oh, Orlando, ask thyself, why should this now portend that a queen must now walk abroad, and thy face does seem to make her haunt?
I do not, Majesty.
What canst thou know so young?
I
know of age, and how it hungers. Old women's hearts are intricate, are mazes, strung together by a thousand fears, where courage wars with terror, frailty with both. But thou, sweet boy, we hear sports jet a heart,
my queen,
unshadowed of innocence, uncracked, a frame unstained, full set to be a proper man's. Blushes, sir, the damask rose smells sweetest.
Your Majesty.
Yet roses fade and petals fall, an arm we need to walk us to our grave, and on thee lights our last and private choice. She offers, sir, does not use to beg.
And I, Your Majesty, give in return but this.
Ah, victory!
But more, Your Majesty, more I cannot give.
Cannot die as a beggar, you are too proud. And innocence thy mask. I read you like a book. So come, sirrah.
Gregor Samsa awoke one morning from uneasy dreams.
He found himself transformed in his bed into a gigantic insect.
His numerous legs, which were pitifully thin compared to the rest of his bulk, waved helplessly before him.
What has happened to me?
He thought.
This was no dream.
He looked at the alarm clock ticking on his chest.
6:30, and the hands were quietly moving on.
Gregor,
said a voice.
That gentle voice.
It was his mother's.
His mother's.
Mother's.
I'm Gregor Samsa. There's my sister Greta.
There's brother Gregor.
Isn't it nice that she wakes up for me?
I always wait up for him.
Glass of milk on the table, and then bed. Up again at 4 a.m. Yes, 4 a.m. to catch the 5 a.m. train.
He doesn't come home very often.
Day, what a life. What an exhausting job. And I picked it.
He works so hard.
The warehouse was better. One didn't have to worry about all the travelling.
It was very good.
I feel sick.
Gregor!
Cash!
Gregor!
Shoe!
Gregor!
Cigar!
Gregor!
Food!
Gregor!
Beer!
Gregor!
Hunt!
Milk! Gregor!
Thanks. You're up late. Why aren't you in bed?
I thought I'd wait up for you. What's the matter?
My back's aching. Must be from carrying those samples all day. Shh! Listen!
What?
It's raining. Hear it beating on the window gutter.
It's been raining all day for ages.
Oh, God.
What is it?
I'm so exhausted.
Go to bed then!
Always tired, travelling day in and day out. I don't know what's happening to me. All my joints feel stiff.
Perhaps you shouldn't go in tomorrow. Don't go in. I'll call a doctor in the morning.
No!
Why not?
It will look suspicious. You go to bed now.
And have a good night's sleep.
But I'll make you a lovely breakfast in the morning.
I could sleep forever. Good night, Greta.
Good night, Gregor. It's 6:30. Where's Gregor?
6:30. Oh dear. Perhaps the alarm clock's not gone off.
Did you set it?
Set it? Yes, I set it for 4:00.
Gregor? Oh, Greg, it's 7:15 already. Shouldn't you be at work?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Mother. I'm getting up now. What has happened to me? Everything seems the same. It's still raining outside. Oh, my legs. What's happened to my legs? Turn over and go back to sleep. It's a bad dream. I can't turn over. I can't turn.
Gregor.
Shut my eyes. I'm dreaming. It'll all go away. It's nonsense. It must go away. Must sleep. But I can't sleep on my back.
Gregor.
It's 6:45. I have to work. Oh, why didn't I hear the alarm? The next train leaves at 7:00 and my samples aren't even packed. And even if I caught the train, there'd be a row. Oh, I knew I was sick yesterday.
Gregor, aren't you feeling well? Are you needing something?
Yes, yes, I'm just ready. Won't be a minute.
Oh, dear. That's bound to be someone from the warehouse.
No, Mr. Sansa. It's the chief clerk.
I'm terribly sorry, but our son's not feeling very well. I don't quite know what's wrong with him. He's very conscientious, and you know, he thinks of nothing but his work.
What a villain! It is impossible to be a couple of hours late without sending the chief clerk himself to investigate, giving my family something fresh to worry about. Mustn't hit my head. Mustn't lose consciousness now.
Gregor, the chief clerk says...
He's worried.
Why, you are not at work.
Yes, yes, I only want to get up without disturbing anyone. Put my clothes on and have my breakfast. Must push. Push. Harder. Harder. Ah!
Sounds like someone fell in the next room.
Excuse me. Gregor! The chief clerk is here to see you.
Gregor!
He's not very well, believe me.
Wants to know why you didn't go into work today.
What else am I to Mr. Troy?
We don't know what to say to him.
Gregor!
It's an unpunished word.
Gregor!
Besides! He wants to talk to you privately.
Gregor!
Makes me almost cross the way he never goes out in the evening.
So please, open the door!
Dancing at things like that.
He won't mind if your room's untidy.
He just sits there reading and studying the railway timetable.
Please, Gregor, you'll get in trouble.
The only news would you get to some new fretwork. Do you know he would spend 3 evenings making a lovely picture frame? He's very clever with his hands. I'm just sure he's not very well. It's just not very like him.
I can't think of any other explanation, madam. And while I hope it's not serious, I must say that in business one must ignore slight indispositions. Work must go on.
Gregor! Once and for all, will you let the chief clerk in?
Leave me in peace!
Mr. Sansa! What is the matter with you? Why have you barricaded yourself in your room just answering yes and no all the time and neglecting your business duties in an incredible fashion? The chief hinted a possible reason for your disappearance was the funds you're entrusted with.
Oh, no!
I, of course, defended you, but seeing your behavior now makes me doubt the wisdom of my actions.
He's an honest boy!
He'd never do that!
Never! I'm Gregor! Open the door, please!
Oh, no!
Door! You have another key.
Another key? I don't think so. We've never needed more than one key before.
Does he always lock himself in?
He never used to. Snappity got into through travelling in strange hotels. So he should always lock the door at night. He's very prudent like that.
I intended to discuss this with him in private, but as he's wasted my time, I don't see why I should. For some time past, his work at the firm has not been up to scratch, Mr. Sanger, and it can't go on much longer.
Sir, I'm just going to open the door this very minute. Slight illness, an attack of giddiness kept me in my bed. Getting up now, just a moment longer. I'll catch the 8 o'clock train. Don't let me detain you. Please make my excuses to the chief.
Oh, no.
Is your man out of world? Is he trying to make fools of us?
Shh. He's turning the key. Shh.
Good, Gregor, good.
Shh. Gregor, open the door.
Come on, Gregor, open
up. Sounds off.
Encourage him, don't threaten.
Gregor!
Open the door. Gregor!
Nearly there. Now pull down again.
She was just doing what is right, what is needed. It's what the inner party wants us to do. Is it not?
Yes, but what do you... No! No! Please, no!
What is happening, Parsons? Where are they going?
Winston, the week I've been here, I've seen many come and go. Nobody knows where they're going.
No! Please! No! What? Stop! Ah!
I don't know any goddamn tell. I don't even know where myself where I'm going. The Falcon was going to a bad place, but... Colstein's agents, supporters, they go to a place so unimaginable.
And what of me?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
Where would I go, Parsons? Please, please,
please. Depends, Winston. What exactly did you do?
I was given a choice. I was given Goldstein's diary. I tried to read it.
Oh, Winston. No, Winston. My friend, you've done something truly.
No, please, I'm sorry. No, please, please,
Parsons.
There's nothing you can do for him now. He's gone forever.
Where is he gone?
Where all traitors go. To see him?
Who?
The man behind the door. I can still envision him. How scary his eyes, dark eyes staring into your soul. And the others, I can hear them, their screams. They still haunt me. The ones that got taken away, the people who, it's so hard being a person these days.
What do you mean?
In here, everybody bleeds, Winston. Everybody gets taken, Winston. You're no different. They are coming for me. I hear them, they are coming for me. Take me! Take me, please! Yes!
Guards.
No, no,
Alistair.
Do you know where you are?
In the room that they speak of.
Do you know how long you've been here?
No.
Do you know why you're here? Shall I tell you why we brought you here?
To cure you. To make you sane. You're a prisoner of your own twisted delusions.
That was 40. You can see that the numbers run up to 100. Do remember that during this session, I have the authority to inflict pain in you whenever I choose, and to whatever degree I choose.
You know very well what is the matter with you, Winston, the thought criminal. Although you have fought against the knowledge, you are mentally deranged. You suffer from a defective memory. An example! Which power is Oceana currently at war with?
East Asia. Oceana is at war with East Asia.
East Asia. Good. And East Asia has always been at war with Oceana, has it not? Please, tell me what you think you remember.
I remember. Before I was arrested, we were not at war with East Asia at all. It was Eurasia.
Increase to 60.
What? Alistair. What? No.
Now, you mentioned photographs which you believe you held in your hand. Look at me.
No.
Look at me! They never exist.
They do exist! They exist in memory! I remember! You remember!
I do not remember. Only the disciplined mind can see reality, Winston. Do you remember writing in your diary that freedom is the freedom to say that 2 + 2 = 4?
Yes.
Good. Now, let's play a little game, shall we? I am holding up 3 fingers, am I not, Winston?
4.
80, Alistair.
But no!
Oh, Winston. I thought you would have learnt by now. How many?
4. Or anything else you'd like. Will you please just stop the pain? I can't take very much more. How can I help when I see in front of my very eyes? 2 and 2 makes 4.
Sometimes, Winston. But only if the party says it does. 100, Alistair.
Oh, please.
Wow. Totally unfazed. for what it's worth, I do admire your trust in your own insanity, Winston. But a man of your stature deserves far better than this. It is time for you to meet him. Welcome to Room 101.
You are about to face your greatest fear, Winston. It will fix you.
Then. No, not properly. I mean, who is? No, I used to work for a doctor. He used to threaten to take some of his books home to read. Then, one of me neighbours went funny during the change, you know. She thought everyone was talking about her, saying her house smelt. I looked it up and it was called paranoia. It sort of stuck in me mind. Between you and me, though, a roasted smell.
I wish I could remember that word. Still, Ray will be back soon. She'll tell you.
What's she here for, then?
She's not been right down below.
Waterworks?
Well, near there. Very near.
Baby trouble.
Not exactly baby trouble in that area.
Dropped at it.
Has what dropped?
A womb.
I think he's more stuck than dropped.
Stuck in? Never heard of that one.
In this age of medical technology, an old age pensioner is weaning into a Coca-Cola bottle using a magazine as a funnel.
Look at it in the standard, wouldn't it, dear?
Mrs. Lovett, would you want to dress and go and sit on the cubicle on the right, please, Mr. Riley? Won't keep you long.
Yes, he will keep her long. He's just got his tea and biscuits. I saw him do the crack in the door. Oh, and another thing, Mrs. Lovett, take your time. Don't put your feet in them stirrup things. Let them learn to look at our faces first, instead of our bums. It's undignified for all concerned.
Mrs. O'Neill, I must ask you not to interfere with medical matters. You are not qualified to give advice to these ladies.
And you are not qualified to give advice to me, you sweet little school leaver, making an old age pensioner wee into a Coca-Cola bottle.
Dear, I couldn't manage much. Is that enough?
You can have some of mine if you like. That'll baffle the sods.
That's enough. Now shut up. You're getting all of this free, you know. It's bad enough working with disgusting, ill people all day without having them being rude to me as well. I've had enough. I'm off. I shall have to report to you, Mrs. O'Nions.
Oh, well, now you've done it, Ray. She's not suited to the job, is she? One day she might have a difficult patient to deal with. I'm only giving her a bit of training. Anyway, now she's gone. Let's talk. All of us.
Go on. Let's get comfy. Go on, dear. Take a seat.
You? Not waiting to see the gynaecologist, are you? Don't want a sex change.
I'm accompanying my wife and I'd rather you didn't speak to us.
Oh, go on, let yourself go. You're as wound up as a milkman's alarm clock. Anyway, maybe your wife does want to take part. Don't ask him, do you want to take part? Are you mute? Are you lip reading? If so, I will speak very clearly. One more time. Do you want to take part? Question mark.
I can speak, but if my husband doesn't want me to take part, then I won't.
Do my ears deceive me? You've just put women's liberation back 10 years. I bet Christabel... What's it is whirling in her grave.
Pancras. Christabel Pancras.
Thanks, dear. Now, you can tell me your name, can't you? Your hubby won't mind.
It's Mrs. Audrey Lemon.
Oh, we make a right pair, don't we? Onions and lemons. It's like that kid's song. Onions and lemons.
Oh, oranges. It is oranges.
I forbid you to speak another word to my wife. She needs a very sheltered life. She's an extremely nervous disposition.
Oh, I get nerves. Now... And again.
Audrey, does he always speak to you like this?
I suppose he does.
Today will be the last day, Audrey. You have my word.
It doesn't bother me, not really.
Oh, well, it bothers me, dear.
Audrey needs a firm hand. She can be headstrong.
By the look of it, she needs a firm something.
Why are you here, Audrey, dear? Is something wrong?
Audrey.
We've been married 5 years, and...
Audrey.
James has been waiting for children to come along and they haven't yet, so
Audrey,
I've got to have some tests.
I won't tell you again. You will not discuss our private life with this woman.
James, Mrs. Onions is quite right. I ought to be allowed to speak if I want to.
I'm warning you, Audrey. Open your mouth one more time and I'm off. You can face the doctor on your own.
Please, James, it can't do any harm.
Have you gone mad? I just told you to keep your mouth shut.
Well, I won't.
Shut it.
No.
Shut your mouth.
Get bloody. Lost!
Audrey, you swore!
I might swear again.
Think of your mother!
Bugger!
Audrey!
I might say a really bad word.
God help you, Audrey!
You need this help
the brethren.
You can tell them to bugger off too. I'm sick of seeing their miserable faces. No smoking, no drinking, no Christmas, not even a blood transfusion.
You've lost your faith.
I've never had it, James. Every week trudging around and preaching the message nobody wants to hear. You've seen their faces change when they realise who we are. And, James, I don't believe we saved Armageddon. If it comes to it, we'll die like the rest.
You're past saving now. I'll have to leave. You're an agent of the devil with your bleached hair and cigarettes.
I am a natural blonde. I will show you my armpits if you like.
Ja, ja.
Los, los, beweg dich. Ja, das ist die letzte Ladung. Die letzte Ladung, habe ich gesagt.
And there are rooms which are sometimes forgotten.
Unvisited for months on end, they wilt, become overgrown with bricks and lost once and for all to our memory, forfeit the only claim to existence. Once, early in the morning towards the end of winter, I visited such a forgotten chamber. From all the crevices in the floor, from all the mouldings, from every recess there grew slim shoots, filling the grey air with a scintillating filigree lace of leaves. Around the bed, under the lamp, along the wardrobes, clumps of delicate trees, which high above spread their luminous crowns. Enormous white and pink flowers blossomed among the leaves, bursting with bud before your very eyes, and then falling apart in a quick decay. And before nightfall, there is no trace left of that splendid flowering. The whole elusive sight was a fata morgana, an example of the strange make-believe of matter which had created a semblance of life.
Er hat die Knaben, bot in der Arm.
A fast insecure. Ear hard in bomb.
Theodore.
Leon. Psst.
Joseph.
Adela.
My God, Joseph, you're a stinless rake.
Emil.
Hombre, Joseph. Pero que alegría, chico. How wonderful to see you. You've changed. You're a man now. Joseph, there was a Toyota found in Madagascar. I found these photos. Fotografías de chicas desnuditas. Mira que titas son las chicas de Madagascar. De Madagascar.
¿Qué pasa?
De Madagascar.
Joseph!
How extraordinary.
Father.
Even these wild and spacious late winter skies are transformed by the arrival of returning birds. Look. Look, flying hither and thither within the elaborate of eternal matter.
Father! Father! Mother!
Joseph! Spring! What is it in the air of a spring dusk? All trees regain their sweetness and wake up their twigs. And yet there are so many whispers which lie buried underground and are forgotten. Who can understand that great and sad machinery that spring is? The tree roots want to speak. Memories awake. Ah, Joseph. Freshly starched underskirts and new silk stockings rustle on park benches. Their stories are rejuvenated and their plot starts again. But others remain unborn. And beautiful spring leaves vicariously on the rejected lives of unborn tales.
Mother! 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 Spring!
Yes!
The stars, look! A shooting star. The moon! Look, the moon.
No.
Yes.
No, I'm looking for my other half.
Well, sorry, I don't have it. Hey, Sarita, wait, please, Sarita, wait! Sarita!
Joseph!
Adela!
What are you doing out so late?
Adela! 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 My God! These people.
Joseph?
Señorita! Hey, Señorita, wait, Señorita!
Joseph! Joseph! Mother. Look! The moon! The moon!
Yes, Mother, the moon.
Joseph! The stars!
Yes, the stars.
Isn't it beautiful?
Hey, Señorita, wait! Tell me your name!
It's been a very difficult 20 minutes, but we have reached a decision, and nobody is to sit here looking nervous or anxious and worried about things. Just before I hand over to the amazing Mr. Hall, we have to give out the Performing Arts Award, and that's an award which I give out. And it's to somebody who's in the upper sixth form, who has done the most extraordinary work over the last 4 or 5 years, who has performed and directed in house drama, in school plays. It could be for a technician, could be for a performer. And I'm afraid I've bottled it this year. I just can't separate out from this extraordinary upper sixth form that we have. So I would like the following people just to stand up so you can applaud them in a moment. And that is Harrison Brown, Anya Stanicop, Paris Siviter, Jess Whitlock, Fred Hansen, Theo Gilbert-Birch, Izzy Rusling, Jemima Vaughan Hawkins, Jake Wingfield, Marcus Al Young, Tando Beth, Chi Lam, Callum Wilkinson, Olivia Whitfield, Charlotte James, and Joseph Hong, because you have been amazing. Please stand up. But I've ran out. But I thank you very much for your amazing work. Over to you, sir.
Well, firstly, thank you for kind of inviting me here to do this. It's just been a really wonderful evening seeing such young talent. I've arrived and was given a glass of wine and then met 10 Death in Paradise fans who were very complimentary. For me, it's a win-win. But to then sit for 90 minutes or whatever it was and just be... I said to Tim when we walked out, it just flew by. It really did. And before I kind of get to the performances themselves, the technical staff were just amazing. I don't know how you pull that off, but to zip through all of those different pieces effortlessly and without any flaws whatsoever, I would say a round of applause for... I stand here as a writer. Writers are generally introverts who have chosen to sit behind a keyboard at home because they don't like to socialise. So excuse me if this is not as wonderful as it could be, but I'll do my best. I think the other thing that I was thinking about watching this is that writers, actors and directors, I think the common link between them is truth and finding truth. And as a writer, even on something as kind of fun and, dare I say, silly as Death in Paradise, you're still trying to find the truth of the scene and the moment. And I think that's what actors do. When you speak to actors in the profession, they talk about finding the truth of their character, of the scene, of the moment. And I think it's the director's job to help the actor find that truth. So I think we're kind of linked by that common bond of just trying to find a human truth in what it is we do. And watching all of the pieces tonight, I was kind of blown away by how committed all of you were to those pieces. And I kind of felt that what linked them was that truth, that you'd all clearly chosen those your separate pieces, your plays, for a reason that you believed in and you wanted to the piece to speak out. And that was really clear. And I think that's a real testament to all of you involved. So my second round of applause for the night is to just all of the performers and the directors involved. I think you've done really well. So please ask me just to sort of go through each performance, each house, and just I'll sit through kind of just thoughts that I felt. I'm going to gush a lot, I'll be honest now, because I was broadly blown away by everything. But hopefully this will sort of speak to you. So the first one's Walter's house, leaving Tommy. I thought this was lovely. I always, and I'm going to say this about a later piece as well, I think there's something poignant when you see young actors in war plays. There's just something that I think we all know, that particularly in period pieces, that young men went to war, and that resonates that so much when you see people of your age performing in them. I thought you evoked the period really well. I loved the stillness of it, and you had the confidence to let the character's story just speak. It kind of felt effortless, and I loved the little sound effects of the gunfire during the piece. Really brought that to life. I thought it was lovely. The second Mary Windsor house for Everyman. I loved this. I didn't think you could make a morality play entertaining, and yet you did. It felt really, from the moment that the young former walked on in scrubs, I was kind of fascinated as to why, drawn in by that. It was very attention grabbing. It felt kind of current. I loved the diverse casting within it. It felt inventive. And you drew humour from it, which is a real achievement, as I say, from a morality play. I love the modern archetypes, and you kind of brought, I think, was sort of, you know, a very tricky period piece to life. And I loved the sort of slightly cynical summing up at the end, which kind of undercut it all. I thought it was a very fresh, inventive take on that play. The History Boys, I love Alan Bennett, and you got the laughs from it. Really brought the humour out. I thought as well, it's tricky when you're all playing characters of kind of the same age, your own age. That's quite a tough ask, but you did find the different characterisations within them. And I thought the young actor playing the teacher did a really great job of just separating himself and feeling genuinely older than the other ones, which is quite a tough ask. I also thought the young actor playing Dakin was brilliant, really well done. You shone. So well done. Oakley House for Inspector Calls. Again, I'm just going to sound like I'm gushing a lot, and I apologise. But I genuinely loved this. I thought I'm a big Priestley fan, and I love this play, and I loved the kind of feminist take on it because you made me think about it in a way that I never had. I thought the opening of the sort of the four or five white performers at the back and the lights coming up was really striking. And stepping out of the darkness, it brought a real theatricality to it. And I was kind of gripped by that. But then as it went on, this play that I'd always thought of as a kind of very socialist play suddenly became, as I say, a feminist play. And I kind of want to reread it now and reconsider it in that light. So genuinely thank you for sort of bringing that concept to it and making me think about it in that way. Yeah, I thought I knew that play, and now I'm going to revisit it. So well done. Thomas Cook's House, Our Friend Jack. I thought it was great from the moment. I think, was it the Psycho music from Psycho kicked in? I was there for it. It was quite startling. The fact that you used the whole space was brilliant. I love that. I thought the period sort of accents, the East End accents were great. I just loved the sort of doing a female kind of take on Jack the Ripper story, which we all kind of know, we're all very familiar with, but finding that fresh angle on it, again, felt very new to me, and I think the sort of, the best thing I can say is that I just want to see the rest of that, really. I'd like to read what happens in that and where it goes. I thought you brought a real tension to it as well. And I kind of, as a murder mystery man, the Ripper mnemonic in the newspaper, that might get into Death in Paradise. we'll talk about copyright later. So yeah, well done. I thought it was smashing. The birthday party for Lyttelton House. Again, I'm a big Pinter fan. I'm not sure I was in Stan Pinter, but I'm a fan. I thought this was great. It felt like you as performers were very in control of the pace of the piece, and that you knew absolutely what you wanted to do with it. Pinter is all about rhythm, and I know we all know it, and it's all about the pauses, and I thought you got the rhythm and the timing of the sort of the pauses absolutely spot on. It felt, again, a word I'm going to sort of use a lot, it just felt effortless, but I could see that there was a lot of work in that, particularly in those sort of rapid-fire dialogue sections. I thought you aged up really well. There was a real maturity in the performances, which is hard to do. And again with Pinter, there is humour in there, and you brought that out. I thought it was very confidently done, and you held the audience. And it was, you could feel that in the audience. Elmhurst House, Long the Short the Tall. I really enjoyed this. I actually have a personal connection to this play, which I won't go into now. but if the actors want to find me afterwards, I have
James's
to...
James's dad wrote that play.
thank you, Tim. I was going to be modest and discreet, but I have a great anecdote, which I can't say in public, but if the actors want to find me, I can share a wonderful anecdote about that play with you. I thought this was great. I thought you did a wonderful job. Particularly in the staging, it's really hard to manage kind of eight actors in a Malayan hut. And make it feel like sort of there's genuine tension within that while everyone else is doing their own little thing. So I thought the staging was great. And I thought the movement in the fight sequence was beautifully handled. And again, it's just such a poignancy when you see, I don't know what your ages were, but sort of 14, 15, 16-year-olds playing those parts in a war play. It resonates so much more, and I think you evoked a real genuine tension in that whole sequence, so congratulations, well done. Hazeldene House, Orlando. I thought this was, again, sort of focusing on, I thought the staging was captivating, and actually really, really smart. There was stillness at the front of the stage, while the sort of the movement at the back felt like it had been really considered and very well done. And there was sort of a professionalism to it. I always felt like I was watching a West End production there, because it just, as I say, it felt a very smart way of staging that. You brought out the humour, which I thought was great. And I've written, I didn't make many notes on this because I was just kind of drawn into it, which is sort of really all I need to say, that I got to the end and realised I hadn't scribbled much down, which I think is sort of testament that it was sort of beautifully done, and I was kind of captivated by it. So thank you, well done. Schoolhouse Metamorphosis. I thought this was fabulous. The opening image was brilliant. It felt like a really confident staging. Felt like you knew exactly what you wanted to do with it. I loved the Brummie accent, so good choice for actor. But you brought it to life. It was another one where I just would have quite happily sat and sort of watched the whole play, really. It was very energised. And just very thoughtful performances. And there was humour in it, but by the end, you still managed to bring a poignancy to a sort of an expressionistic play, which is, I think, a real achievement. So, well done. 1984... for the Wendron-Gordon House. I said this to Tim, I'm really pleased that you chose to do this, because I think Orwell is as relevant as he ever was at the moment. And, you know, we've seen images on the telly over the last few years that were so clear tonight of people being dragged away. He is... 1984 and you know, Animal Farm speak as much now, as I think, as they did when they were written. So the fact that you chose this, was brilliant. I loved the stark staging, the sort of the all black stage with just people sat there being dragged away. I thought that worked really well. It felt genuinely sinister. And then when you kind of filled the stage with bodies again. I've written epic here, it had a kind of epic staging feel to it. And I thought the diversity of the casting worked really well and brought an added kind of poignancy to it. And I just loved the idea of the electrocution running through all the people. I don't know if this is a helpful note, but it felt like something out of a PlayStation game to me. But it looked brilliant and felt really fresh and inventive. So well done, thank you. Ottilie Hild House, Womberang. I loved this, it was really enjoyable. I thought there was a great sense of the 80s period, which you evoked beautifully. I thought you handled the comedy brilliantly. I'm sure, I hope the performers heard it, but there was real laughter in this audience. And that, it's kind of cliche, but it's harder to do comedy than it is drama. So to, in your 5 minutes or whatever it was, to get that reaction is testament to your skill with that. I thought you also brought a kind of distinct characterization to all the different roles within it. You all sort of owned your characters and knew who they were. It was another one. I just enjoyed being in that world, which is sort of quite a simple thing to say, but I think it was another one where I just sort of wanted to put the pen down and just really live and feel that world of those brilliant women. So thank you, well done. And then final piece, Housman Hall, Street of Crocodiles. I said to Tim, the word that I've sort of written a few times is just beautiful. I just thought it was beautiful. The staging was beautiful. The use of sound was evocative. The moment where the bookcases parted, I thought was brilliant, really theatrical and inventive. And so much, again, in just 5 minutes, there was so much movement within it, which is really hard. That kind of blocking and to make it as fluid and as beautiful as it was, it takes real skill. I thought it was very inventive. I loved the kind of the chairs being held up as trees. I thought that was great. I guess the nicest thing I can say is that I didn't know this play at all, but it makes me want to go and read it. I was really touched by it and moved by the end, which is a real achievement again in 5 minutes. So those are my sort of reactions to headlines.
Thank you very much. That was brilliant. Thank you very much. Can we have a round of applause? If I could very kindly invite you onto the stage, because we've got to that moment now where you're going to give out some certificates and cups. Thank you very much, Headmaster. Do you want to announce what they are?
Yes, so the award for the best actor runner-up goes to Olivia Whitfield. runner-up for best play goes to Schoolhouse for Metamorphosis.
Night for a lot of us. It's our final performance on the stage, so thank you for being a part of it.
Thank you.
Firstly, I'd like to say a massive thank you to everyone behind the scenes. So that's Charlotte, Joseph, Rooksang, Mr. Poxon, Mr. Jude, Mrs. Whitfield, and everyone who has been absolutely influential in making tonight. Thank you. Secondly, I'd like to address the massive elephant in the room, and that is that no one has yet to thank the most important person here, and that is Mr. Norton. Over the last 5 years that myself, Jess, and the rest of the upper six have been here, Mr. Norton has helped with organising house dramas like this one, directing school senior productions, even helping us out with GCSE and A-level pieces. So I just want to say on behalf of myself, Jess, everyone who has performed tonight, an enormous thank you to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for your patience. What a wonderful evening. Now you can go home. Congratulations.